Hello everyone and welcome to Boundless Dentistry. In this video we'll talk about the basic fundamental principles that are used for tooth preparation. Firstly, we'll talk about what actually is a cavity, then how do we classify different types of caries lesions that are present, and before starting actual tooth preparation we'll talk about different factors that are to be considered before the tooth preparation starts. And then finally we'll talk about the different walls internally and externally that are present in a cavity and the different angles that are present in the cavity. So let's get started. Now firstly, talking about what actually is a cavity. Cavity is basically a defect that is present in the tooth. You can see in this diagram present on your lower bottom screen, you can see this brown highlighted structure over here. This is the diseased part of the structure that is present in the teeth, and this is present due to the bacterial action that leads to a formation of caries. So when this caries forms, this lesion starts to develop in the teeth. The lesion can initially be present in the enamel only, but later on it can involve the dentine, and then finally it can involve the pulp as well. Our ideal goal is that we stop the caries lesion as soon as possible, and the most importantly avoid involving the pulp, because that is the main vital tissue that we want to save in order to save the tooth from endodontic treatment. Now talking about defining cavity preparation is a mechanical alteration of the diseased part of the tooth surface. You can see on this right hand side of the diagram, this blue part. Initially this was the caries lesion, and when you do the cavity preparation, you remove this entire area. Like you can see over here, you form a smooth angle and a smooth cavity over here, and then you place your restorative material over here, and the tooth is saved from involving the pulp. So the entire caries lesion is removed and the tooth is restored back to its normal structure. Now when choosing appropriate restorative materials, some important things have to be kept in mind. First are the aesthetics. Sometimes the amalgam restoration, which you all know, is grayish black in color, so most people don't prefer it because of obvious reason, aesthetics. Sometimes functional problems as well. Sometimes amalgam performs better than composite, and sometimes it's other way around, so that is also to be kept in mind. And then the normal form of the cavity that is to be restored. So these few important points are to be kept in mind when you are doing your cavity preparation and selecting an appropriate restorative material. Now before you start doing the cavity preparation, there are certain objectives that you keep in mind, so that will help you in designing the cavity and then restoring it properly. First, the thing that you keep in mind is removing the diseased part of the tooth, that is the caries lesion. You have to remove that in order to protect the pulp. Secondly, you try to make the restoration as conservative as possible. And what do we mean by that? We mean that only the caries structure is to be removed, and the normal tooth structure that is present, no, it should not involve that part, so that least amount of the caries lesion that is necessary is removed and the other healthy tooth structure is saved. And then when you restore the tooth and then you apply the restorative material, proper form of the restorative material is necessary so that it can perform their necessary masticatory function. And finally, aesthetics, which you discuss with the patient, is also very important. So these four objectives you keep in mind before you start your cavity preparation. Now there are certain factors that affect tooth preparation. We'll discuss them one by one. First is the pulp and the periodontal status. If, for example, the pulp is involved and the periodontal status of that tooth is very compromised, then the most probable option that you go towards is extraction. For example, if the tooth is undergoing severe periodontal disease, so if that tooth is so mobile, for example, like grade 3 mobility, you can't restore that tooth by doing cavity filling and endodontic treatment, because that tooth is bound to be exfoliated. So you don't do a filling process in that tooth. Secondly, you assess the occlusal relationship of that teeth. Thirdly, before you start doing the cavity preparation, you have to know the dental anatomy of the tooth. For example, how many roots are present, how many cusps are present, if there is some cusp present or not, if there are some fractures that are present, grooves and pits. These all factors you have to keep in mind so that you can design the best cavity possible. Fourthly, there are some patient factors that you consider. For example, the age of the patient. The normal young adults prefer aesthetic restoration as compared to older adults. socio-economic state is also to be considered, because according to that you offer the treatment to the patient. For example, not every person can afford the best treatment because that is expensive. So you consider the socio-economic status of the patient and then you give them the proper treatment. Aesthetic concern is also one of the most important things that the patient is concerned about, that the restoration to be as natural, resembling to the tooth color as possible. And then finally, medical conditions as well, because sometimes when you performing the dental procedures, prolonged procedures are hectic for some patients. For example, cardiac patients or patients who are asthmatic, have COPD, so they can't lie flat for a very long period of time, and then they generate stress and anxiety, which can further exacerbate the underlying medical condition. Fifth, you assess the caries assessment of the patient, and if the patient's caries assessment is high, that is the patient is more prone to develop caries, you have to control the caries of the patients first before you actually do the restorative material, because if you do not control the caries, the further teeth will be diseased. So you have to control the caries process before you actually start restoring the teeth. And sixth and important part is conserve the tooth structure. Only the diseased part of the tooth is removed and the natural tooth structure is not to be touched. It is to be left as it is. And seventh is the choice of restorative material, because the choice of restorative material is to be discussed with the patient, and then the dentist give its best advice to the patient that, for example, amalgam is best for him or composite is best for her or any other restorative material that suits best for the patient. Now, after we have considered the factors that are to be noted before starting the cavity preparation, next we talk about what actually the caries lesions are and where are these caries lesions present. And we can define it by using different terms, for example, using G.V. Black's classification or using locations. So first we'll talk about the smooth surface caries. Smooth surface caries are those caries which are present mostly on the buccal and the palatal or lingual surface. You can see in this diagram, this is the smooth surface caries because the surface is smooth. There's hardly any grooves or any pits, fissures, so this is a smooth surface that is present, and if caries develop on them, it's known as smooth surface caries. It can also occur palatally or lingually. Second is the pits and fissures caries, and these are most commonly found in your posterior teeth and even more commonly in your molars. As you can see in this picture, these stained lesions, these linear lesions you can see over here, are your pits and fissure caries. And then you can also use G.V. Black's classification to define the different caries lesions location. Now, another way to classify caries location is by talking about backward caries and forward caries. Backward caries basically means that the caries spread at the dentino enamel junction, this junction you can see over here, is greater than the lesion of the caries present over the enamel. You can see this lesion present around the dentino enamel junction is greater, the caries lesion here is greater as compared to the enamel. So when this is the case, it's known as backward caries. If we flip this over, it's known as forward caries. Forward caries basically means that the caries lesion either is greater than the dentinal caries or it's equal to dentinal caries. So if when these two are equal or enamel caries is greater than dentinal caries, it's known as forward caries. Residual caries are that caries which are left behind when you have completed your tooth preparation. For example, you started your tooth preparation and then certain caries lesion you miss out. So when these small caries lesion are missed out, these are known as residual caries, and these are important and these have to be removed so that caries lesion does not develop again and the tooth can be restored properly. Second is your root surface caries. Now, root surface caries is mostly common in those people who have their tooth surface abraded due to aggressive toothbrush, and in elderly people who retain their tooth beyond their normal period. For example, in your history, the teeth were not retained in elderly because of the lack of treatment options that were present, but since today different treatment options are present, so the elderly people can retain their tooth, but because of gingival migration, root surface caries are now more common in your elderly population. So you can see over here, this is your exposed root. The clinically you can see this root is exposed, and when caries develop on this part of the tooth, it is known as root surface caries. This is the area you can see in this tooth as well, and this as well. You can see how this tooth surface is abraded. Secondary or recurrent caries are those caries that develop between the junction of tooth and the restoration. You can see over here, this is the tooth, and you can see this light blue color restoration that has been placed. This is the tooth, and this is your tooth surface, and this is your junction of your restoration. So between them, if caries lesion develop, that is known as secondary or recurrent caries. Now, so far we have discussed the different locations of caries that are present. Now we'll talk about extent of caries that is present. Firstly, we have incipient caries. Now, incipient caries are basically shallow and not that deep caries lesion, and these caries lesion are usually reversible. Now, by reversible, we mean that these caries lesion can be remineralized, because caries develop when there is some demineralization, and when these lesions are small, there are chances that it can remineralize and the normal tooth structure can be restored. These are mostly limited to enamel, because they are very small lesion and they do not involve dentine, and when dentine is involved, it is known as cavitated caries that we'll discuss next. So incipient caries are reversible, they do remineralize, they are mostly limited to enamel, they are smooth and they are hard and they are intact, and mostly they are arrested. So there are chances that you can reverse this process and restore the normal tooth structure. On the other hand, we have cavitated caries. The cavitated caries are those that are irreversible. And by irreversible, when we mean that once the demineralization has reached such a depth in the tooth structure, for example involving enamel and dentine, that it cannot be reversed, and now the only option is restoration. So that is known as cavitated caries. A cavity has been developed, enamel mostly is broken down, and dentine is involved, and now there is no other option but restoration is required for that particular tooth. After location and extent, we'll now talk about rate of caries, that is by how much acceleration the caries is spreading. We have two types, either the caries is acute caries or chronic caries. Firstly, acute caries is also known as rampant caries. As the name suggests, the caries process is moving very fastly and is rapidly destroying all the tooth structure that the caries is present, and they are so fast caries that it leads to rapid involvement of the pulp, and it is most common in children because of their eating habits and bottle feeding habits, and in that case it leads to acute caries. On the other hand is chronic caries, also known as slow or arrested caries. These type of caries are most common in adults. They are hard and brown black in structure, and when you move your probe tends to stick to it. And why do we call it arrested? We call it arrested because remineralization has occurred, and when remineralization has occurred, the caries process is stopped. It's present just over there and it is not moving ahead. So that's why it is known as arrested caries, and thus these chronic caries are more common in adults. Furthermore, we have enameloplasty. Now, enameloplasty is a procedure where shallow caries lesion, mostly in your developmental grooves and pits, like you can see over here in this picture, by these caries lesions are removed mostly in your grooves and pits, and smooth saucer shaped structure are created. Now, what is the purpose of creating such structures? Now, the main purpose is so that self cleansing can occur and these are easily cleaned, because we all know that pits and fissure are most prone to develop caries during this 21st century and 20th century as well. So caries process firstly start in your pits and fissures, and it is important to keep it clean. So enameloplasty basically removes this structure of your pits and fissures and tries to smoothen it out and create a saucer shaped structure so that easy cleaning can occur. Now, when you start your cavity preparation and you are drilling and you are removing the caries lesion, two types of dentines are encountered, and knowing both of them is very important because that affects your cavity preparation. Now, you have to keep in mind all these points that are to be told right now. So starting with affected dentine. Affected dentine is that dentine that is light brown in color. It's light brown in color, and it is that dentine that doesn't have as much bacteria, but the toxins of the bacteria are present. Here demineralization is also present, but remineralization is also occurring. So it is balanced. So the caries process is not resuming forward. These affected dentine is also not easily removed, and that is because remineralization has occurred. And it is not necessary to remove this affected dentine when you are doing your cavity preparation. And research shows that when you only remove the infected dentine that has bacteria and leave out the affected dentine and you place your restoration on top of it, there is no further progression of your caries lesion. So it is important to leave the affected dentine, and especially when it is close to the pulp. So you leave the affected dentine and you only remove the infected dentine. Now, secondly, there is infected dentine, and infected dentine is important because it is that dentine that has to be removed in order to achieve successful restoration of that tooth. It is soft demineralized dentine. Now, here bacteria are present, and this is absolutely necessary to remove, because if it's not removed and it is left in the cavity, caries process will resume, and it is brown black in color. You can actually see it when you are doing your cavity preparation. It is important to differentiate these two when you are doing your cavity preparation. Now there are three type of cavity preparation that are done. First is simple preparation. In this, only one tooth surface is involved, and you can see in this picture only one tooth surface is present. So when this is the case, it's known as simple preparation. Compound preparation is when there are two tooth surfaces involved. You can see in this only one surface was involved, but now this surface along with this surface is involved. So in this case, this will be compound. And complex is when there are three or more tooth surfaces involved. For example, in this case, this surface, and this surface, there are three surfaces. So when that is the case, it's complex. Now moving on towards the tooth preparation walls. There are two types of walls basically. We have the internal wall and then we have the external wall. Firstly, we'll talk about the internal walls. Internal walls are that wall that are prepared surfaces that do not extend to the external tooth surface. There are two types of internal walls. First is the pulpal wall and second is the axial wall. You can see in this diagram, this is your pulpal wall, and pulpal wall is that wall that is perpendicular to the long axis of the tooth and the occlusal forces as well. You can see this is your pulpal wall and this is the long axis. So it's perpendicular to the long axis of the tooth. That is the pulpal wall and it's the internal wall of the cavity. Second is the axial wall. Axial wall is that wall that is parallel to the long axis of the tooth. You can see in the diagram, this is your axial wall and it is parallel to the long axis of the tooth. So these are the two types of internal walls. First is the pulpal wall and the second is axial wall. Now the second type of wall that is present in the cavity is the external wall. External wall is that wall that is prepared surface extending externally. You can see in this diagram, this is your cavity preparation and it's extending externally. So when that is the case, it's known as external wall. You can see the different external walls that are present in this diagram. This is a distal wall, it's facing distally. This is facing the facial side, so it's the facial wall. This is facing the lingual side, so lingual wall. And this is the gingival because it's facing the gingiva. So basically the two types of walls are internal wall and external wall. Internal wall consists of pulpal and the axial wall, and external consists of distal, facial, lingual and gingival walls. Now there's also one more thing, that is the floor or seat. Now floor or seat are the prepared wall that is perpendicular to the long axis of the tooth and the occlusal forces. For example, this is your pulpal wall, that is the floor. You can see it's perpendicular to the occlusal forces that will be directed on this tooth. So when that is the case, it's known as floor or seat. And the two types of walls that are present over here are the pulpal and the gingival floors. This is your one seat and this is the second seat. Now these seats are sometimes formed, and the advantages of these seats are basically stabilization of the restoration. It also helps in distribution of stresses, because when you form these seats, forces are distributed throughout the tooth and there are less chances of fracture. Now moving on towards angles that are present in a cavity. Firstly, we'll talk about two definitions of angle, that is line angle and point angle. By line angle, we mean that when two surfaces meet at a point and an angle is formed, that is known as line angle. On the other hand, point angle is that angle in where three surfaces meet at a junction and they form an angle, and that angle is known as point angle. Now in these two diagrams, you can see the different angles that are formed in the cavity. For example, this is your distopulpal angle, distolingual angle, distofacial angle, facio-pulpal angle. These basically tell you the different surfaces that are meeting and forming an angle over here. For example, you can see this is your pulpal floor that is perpendicular to the long axis of the tooth, and this is the facial surface. So when these two surfaces meet, they form the facio-pulpal angle, and you can apply this principle all over the cavity where two surfaces are meeting. You can also use this when three surfaces are meeting. In this case, this is the distolingual pulpal angle. You can see this surface, the distal surface, the lingual surface and the pulpal surface, they are meeting at a point, these three surfaces. So this is known as point angle, and you can find these all over the cavity, and same is the case with line angle. Occlusally, you can also see different angles that are formed, distofacial, distopulpal, distolingual, where three surfaces are meeting. this is your mesiolingual pulpal angle. So these basically angles are important because these angles have to be rounded. If they are pointed, stresses are built up in the cavity, which you have to prevent in order to get your best cavity and your restoration done. And lastly, we'll talk about cavo surface margin and angle. Now, firstly, talking about what actually is cavo surface angle, it's the angle between the prepared wall and external tooth surface. You can see in this diagram, this is your cavity that has been prepared in which a restoration will be inserted. Now, this is your external surface and this is your internal tooth surface. When these two meet at an angle, that is known as cavo surface angle. Now, an important thing about this cavo surface angle is that it should be around 90 degrees. If it's less than 90 and it's forming an acute angle, there are chances when occlusal forces are inserted over here, the enamel or dentine present over here, which is forming an acute angle, it will fracture. So you have to make sure that this cavo surface angle should be around 90 degrees. It is important. Now, where these prepared wall and the external tooth surface meet, there a junction is formed, and that junction is known as cavo surface margin. So this was all about the basic fundamental principles that are used in tooth preparation. We talked about the different cavities that are present, what actually is cavity, what is cavity preparation, factors that are to be considered before we start tooth preparation. Then talked about location, extent and rate of caries lesions that are present in the tooth. Then we talked about different walls that are present in the tooth. And then we talked about angles in the cavity. And then we finally talked about cavo surface margin and angle. So I hope this video was useful for you. And if you like this video, please like, share, subscribe and press the bell icon. Thank you for watching this video. See you next time.